Uh-huh, we're over here now. Now we can grab this. The tarpaulin cloak is still hanging on the railing. The white rectangle of the Revachol Citizens Militia is clearly visible on its back. As your fingers touch the tarpaulin, it almost feels like the cloak wants to deliver a message of comfort through your fingertips. Esprit de Corps says, I will shield you from the elements and give my life for yours. That's what the cloak is relaying. That's very nice of you. A police cloak made from heavy tarpaulin. It would be nigh wind and waterproof if there weren't three bullet holes scattered on the surface. The signature white rectangle of the RCM covers the garment's back. Plus one Esprit de Corps for taking back the streets, and plus one shivers for know thy neighborhood. So that goes with the jacket? Okay. Esprit de Corps, Visual Calculus, Esprit de Corps, and Shivers. I guess it's better for me wearing that, but I guess... Are they both Harry's? Collecting rainwater. All around you, great machines in quiescence. A composite eye of halogen lights watches you, emitting something. White pine trees are printed under the screen covering. Looks like a forest under snow. Oh, wow. You see faded industrial letting on the platform. Kjalsen means white fjord in Arden. Money. Oh wow, this is a big area. Crane control panel. A rusting control panel with several knobs. Two buttons marked Alamer and Itandre is faded with the use. It seems to control the large crane above. A container is attached to its hook block. Alamer is on, Itandre is off, Encyclopedia says. I'm not mess with this yet. I don't know what I'd be doing it with. I wonder if we can use it to get the body down. I don't think it would reach that far, though. The shipyard ahead is oddly quiet. The great machines are sleeping. Well, it's late. The musk of oil and rust comes from the chasm in front of you. It smells like blood. Whatever that is, we can't even open it. And I can't look at that. Some money over here and something else. Industrial-sized thermos. Smells like burnt coffee. Yeah, so we got burnt coffee and blood. Singing container, container, container. The banner sags under the weight of rain and snow. White waves on red. Asking something. Coffee table. A large table with two huge vacuum-insulated thermal coffee dispenser. Someone has forgotten a small plastic card next to the stack of cups. Pick up the card. Got a union card. You snatch up the red plastic card. It features a black contour of a crane lifting a container. The name Etienne Hogarth is written in the middle. Below it, in smaller text, member of the board. It comes with a magnetic strip meant to open electronic doors. Awesome. Did you just go into keys then? Yeah, the Bardera's union card, aren't? A stair made of pallets leading up. The desk has been cleaned out for the night. A smart man doesn't leave any incriminating documents behind. A taxidermy fish that sells time. Did we do this at the wrong time? Could I not have talked to him? Could I not talk to him? I have to beat him up again. Who knows? Can I talk to him from here?
Container, container, I'll turn you nice and red. Container, container, put the logos on.
Conceptualization says the lyrics to this container song are being made up as he goes along. Encyclopedia says the accent is so thick it's impossible not to notice he's Ubi. From the vanishing peninsula of Ubi Sunt? Spelling correctly, on Monday.
Container, container, used to be well pines. Container, container, now belongs to Evrout.
The tiny man is so engaged in his work, he doesn't notice you. Hi.
Evrout, 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 he looks after everyone. Huh? Well, hey there. How can I help you, master?
He smiles. Empathy says, the look in his deep blue eyes is as sincere as you've ever seen. Kind of makes you feel like a jerk for no apparent reason.
I see you're not a union man, master. Did you get lost? You're not one of them scabs, are you?
A shadow passes over his kind face. All of a sudden, he talks louder. What is it with you people and scabs?
I don't personally mind. Folks are just folks, you know. And folks gotta eat.
He doesn't seem to be waiting for you to answer.
Just some of the other guys don't look too kindly on the scabbing kind, if you know what I mean, mister.
What are you doing with the containers? Oh, I'm just making some covers for them containers here. Yes, I am. So it's easier for the crane operators to spot them. He waves at the containers towering behind him. This is easy for me. What's going on here? Look at the mountains of container rising behind him. The containers in the yard are green in Wild Pine's livery, and the mountain rising behind Leo is all red in Union colors, logic tells us. And conceptualization says it's like some red infection was spreading outwards from the container yard's core. This looks like a massive redecorating operation, Kim. Yes, they're hiding it from the inside. All the red containers have the DeBardo's Union logo on them. Leo, has anyone told you why you need to change the covers? No, not really. He shrugs and continues merrily. Mr. Everett doesn't tell me all the big things. He says I go and tell them to everyone. Thanks, Leo. You've been very helpful. Oh, no trouble at all, mister. No trouble at all, the little guy affirms merrily. Do you work here? Yes, yes. Everybody needs a job, and this is mine. I'm Leonard, by the way. Leonard Bellick. But everyone calls me Leo. The little man raises his hand in a welcoming gesture. I'm like Mr. Everard's right-hand man when Mr. Edgar is out of town, and Mr. Edgar's right-hand man when Mr. Everard is away, he chuckles. Actually, Miss Beaufort is the right-hand man, but she's a lady. A good-hearted chuckle again. Who is this Miss Beaufort? Beaufort? The lieutenant looks up at Leo. A real pretty lady with a skin like those Dew and Sucre candy bars my missus likes so much. Them are real nice to suckle on once the dinner is done and me and the missus sit down beside the radio. But I can't listen to the radio all the time. Does he want to suckle on her? Is that what there's so much to do around here, and I'm always busy keeping things running here. Yes, I am. Yes, I am. Volition says, stay on this Miss Beaufort topic. Oh, Lizzie? She's a real sharp tool. Mr. Everett put her through some fancy school and everything east of the river. 4 years she was gone, and when she came back, she was all fancy and lawyerly. Rhetoric says he respects that word. That's obvious. But she's a real nice girl. Grew up in this near her neighbor, in this here neighborhood. Knows everybody and gets along with everyone. Real pillar of the community one day, I'm sure. Empathy says, for a fraction of a second, there's sadness in his eyes. He goes on. If me, Mrs. and me was to have a child, I'd be really happy if she turned out like her. But she can't have kids. Dr. Lemaitre said no, and she knows about such things. Been a doctor for almost 50 years, she has. He sighs and falls silent, watching you meekly with his blue, blue eyes. Logic says, law school? Could he be talking about Union Fixer, a.k.a. the gardener? Okay, so this... Is this the Union Fixer, the gardener? Kim says, looks like it. I'm not sure what a fixer is, but she's a real nice girl. Smart as a whip, too. The little guy smiles a disarming smile at you. Rhetoric says, telling the gardener you know her name might throw her off. Perhaps something to consider later. The gardener? The real gardener? Or the one that we found out wasn't actually a gardener? Miss Beaufort. Liz Elizabeth Beaufort? Yeah, her name is Elizabeth. So I guess it's her last name we didn't know? Where is everyone? The harbor is empty. Oh, most of the guys are down at the gates keeping the scabs from coming in. He leans in with a confidential look. Actually, they're not there, because everyone went to bed. We're on a strike. The whole union is. You don't have to work when you're on strike. Ha! We haven't worked for 2 months now. Kim says, so no one is working? Not everyone is down there, of course, he chuckles. Mr. Everard is in his office, where he always is, and Jean-Luc is guarding the gate. Pauses to think. But Titus and his boys got into some drunken trouble, and Everard sent them on a nice vacation for a week or so. He stops, but seems eager to tell you more. What trouble did Titus and his friends get into? Oh, I'm not really supposed to talk about that. That's union business. He smiles and leans closer. Him and his boys stirred up something in town. Probably drank too much and got in a fight or something. I heard Mr. Everett telling them to go take some time off. But what did they actually do? I guess the boys got a bit too rowdy and had to let them some steam. I don't really know the details. It's how boys you are, you know. I haven't been in a fight since I was in middle school. Kim says, easy, Leo. Let's keep this on the Hardys. He looks to you for assistance. Rhetoric says, look at him. It's not going to be anything useful anyway. Don't fight it. Better to go with the flow. Go with the flow. Okay, Rhetoric wants me to go with this flow, I think. Okay, Leo, let's hear about this fight you got into. I remember I was the runt of the class, he laughs merrily. The bigger boys always used to pick on me. You see, I had a bit of a temper back in the day. Flew off the handle like nobody's business. But Mr. Everett and his brother always came to help. Once they beat old Noel Becker so bad he needed stitches on his head. He chuckles ahead again. Noel never started another fight with anyone after this. Mr. Everett, Mr. Edgar, real nice guys, mister. You should go talk to Mr. Everett. I'm sure you'll be good friends. He's friends with everyone around here. The little guy starts coughing. Volition says, You're never getting anything useful out of him. It's good enough. You found out Everett has a brother called Edgar, and he helped Leo. You're Ubi, right? Oh, yes. Born and raised in Irish, mister. Mum had to leave my dad after he got a bit violent. Took us here to the new world. I was about 10 then. Too old to lose my accent then. People say us Ubis are up to all sorts of trouble with sheep and other animals and whatnot. I just want you to know there was never any of that where I came from. No, sir. Those are just nasty rumors. Kim says, thank you for clarifying that, sir. Methinks he doth protest too much. What is that container over there? Oh, that one. He looks at the container. That should be empty as far as I know. Lots of containers here have nothing in them. They're just waiting to be loaded up. I'm looking for the leader of the Dock Workers' Union. Oh, you want Mr. Everett, then? He's an awfully nice fellow, he is. Him and his brother are both nice fellows. They've lived their entire lives in this here neighborhood. He coughs, then continues immediately. Guys like Mr. Everett, Mr. Edgar, his brother, are real good guys. Made Martinez what it is today. I'm not sure if that's something to be proud of. Mr. Everett and Mr. Edgar and I went to the same school we did when we were boys. Easy now, Leo. I just want to know where can I find this man? Ah, Mr. Everett is usually in his office, of course. He points to the two joint containers on your right. But he already left for the day. He always leaves around 22. Okay, I'm off. Bye-bye now. He returns to his work. I hope we can come back here. I had a feeling it was in there. Can I look at this? The speaker tower is silent. There is no work to organize. Oh, I got some money here. Fall off. Getting rich. I guess we're not sleeping tonight. I don't know. That controls the crane. So if we want to get through here again, when the guy's actually here, are we going to have to deal with Measure Head again? No, I've just been down here. I mean, I'm thinking we would have to deal with Measure Head again, unfortunately. At least 3 packs worth of cigarette butts. Numerous empty bottles of Commodore Red and potent Pilsner. Inland Empire says all those empty wine bottles and cigarette butts on the ground. Someone partied really, really hard here. Wait, how hard? Well, they went through 6 bottles of potent Pilsner, 3 bottles of Commodore Red, and almost 4 packs of cigarettes. It must have been pretty hard. Did I do this? Well, the lieutenant looks at you, then the bottles. So I can think we can say with relative confidence that it was you. I must have been on an advanced scouting mission in the harbor. Yes, Lieutenant marks dryly. This looks pretty advanced, all right. For now, let's just move on. I can collect all this stuff. So how did I get past Measure Head then? Or whoever was guarding the place before Measure Head came along. Now there's 3 more. Not at all. Okay, what's here? Windows too? This is a night watchman's booth. The name of the door reads René Arnault. So this is where René works. I'm gonna look around. If you must, the lieutenant looks around. But please hurry. We're pretty easy to spot up here. Nothing incriminating catches your eye. The cabinets are clean and their sparse contents meticulously organized. There's a framed photograph on the table. Savoir Affairs looks like the inhabitant is rather pedantic when it comes to order. Take the picture. Photo of a happy couple. It's a black and white photo of a young couple out in a street fair. The man, René, is dressed in a Royal Carabinier uniform. The girl is young and very pretty. She is smiling playfully at the camera. Empathy says René looks like he's about to smile. This photo must be tied to some good memories. Why did you take that picture of René? The lieutenant asks, glancing at the photo. I'm going to ask him about it. You're really interested in that old soldier, he marks, surprised. Not sure I understand your fascination, but sure, as long as it doesn't take up a whole lot of time. A black and white photo of a couple posing in front of a Ferris wheel. The girl is young and pretty, the man clad in fancy uniform and smiling. On the back, a very steady hand has written the words, Revachol Fair, Summer of 91. Ask Renee about the photo. The photo you found in the night watchman's booth, the one with the happy couple. Ask Renee about it. He looked uncharacteristically happy in the picture. Yeah, those two guys. I didn't realize who Renee was, but yeah. Renee and Gaston, was it? Unfortunately, I don't know what else to do. Can I get down there? No, I just gotta stand over there. Back in there. I just want to see something. So what if I mess with the crane? Alamair is on. With a loud grind, the crane shifts overhead, moving a massive metal container through the air. We can get into it then. Think of the topple over. And with a surprisingly quiet thunk, the crane places the container down. Hey, that wasn't quiet. Interfacing says, the harbor sleeps as the strike rages in the distance. The crane can rest again now that its purpose has been fulfilled. Its purpose? What do you mean? Moving this container, of course, for the purpose it was built. For this purpose it has acted, and now it will rest. I can't see how that was worth the ruckus, Kim looks at the crate, except for seeing the crane in action, which I admit was satisfying. The crane does not return to its original position. It does not move at all. Alright, well, now we can see what's in there, I guess? How do I get over there? Go up and around. Before you stands a cargo container, just one of many, in the yard. Kim, I think there's something about this container. Lieutenant sighs. Is this like your thing with the wall again? Maybe? I can't tell. I think we should investigate further. You do? Because I don't. Wait, why not? There are a million containers here. Why are you fixing on this one? It was hanging from the crane. You just pick one out because you wanted to interact with a cargo container. We're not here to interact with containers. We're here to get the body down from the tree. No reply. You attempt to turn the handle to no avail. The doors seem to be mechanically locked. Esprit de Corps says, to your left, the lieutenant considers your actions with some puzzlement. Yeah, I'm puzzled about me as well. Alright, I don't know what else to do back here. It's gonna be a long time. The guy we want to talk to is back in his office. Unfortunately. I'm not sure if or how we can get back in here again. Wait, did I have a pri- Would I have an option with this on? I mean, with this equipped? Measurehead will just leave. He's been defeated. I don't know. We need to come back here when it's daytime. Just this guy now? Can I go back in? Yeah. Maybe it's fine now. Maybe we don't need to get past him anymore. Maybe now it'll just open. I hope so. Classier. There's quite a few things we have to do when it's actually daylight again. How do I... Where do I... Oh, this way. Because we can sleep for free. And poor Kim will escort us all the way back. It's more this way, isn't it? It's getting late and it's snowing. Time to call it a day. Good night, Kim. Good night, officer. We'll meet in front of the shack in the morning. Alright, so... What is this again? Wait, what do we have here? I didn't see that. Oh, on the table you see a bowl of water, a rough soap, and next to it... A small hand mirror, a straight razor soaks inside the wash basin. Is shaving the right call? The water reflects back a vague image of your face, nose bulbous and red hair unkempt, wrinkles lining the eyes and forehead. The stash is gigantic. You'd be looking like a pansy without the chops. A pansy, the physical element says. Physical instrument, rather. It's wise to... Because we might kill ourselves. Time to shave. Get those mutton chops off. Hope we don't die. Bleed to death. Failed. Your hand trembles as you scratch at your cheek. Oh no. That's not how a grown man shaves. Leave it for now. Thank God. I would have cut your throat, hand-eye coordination says. Volition says the centipede is exaggerating. People don't actually cut their own throats when they're shaving. At least not accidentally. I need to put more into hand-eye coordination just to shave. Electrochemistry. Encyclopedia. Alright. So next episode we will rest. And I guess I have more weird dreams with the ancient reptilian brain and limbic system and all that fun stuff. Thanks so much for watching, guys. Hopefully tomorrow, which is Thursday? Well, it's actually already Thursday. It says day 3, even though it's after, it's 1 a.m. But I guess it's day 4 activates when I wake up. So yeah, hopefully Thursday, once we're awake, we can actually get the body down and talk to Mr. Everart. Thanks so much for watching, guys. See you next time. And always, seek adventure.